We've had one proportion, two proportion, one mean, and now two mean. So we're almost done with our Dr. Seuss book tour through statistical inference in Stat 201. We're going to do the statistical inference for two means from independent groups now. So the goal, as with the two proportion situation, the goal is going to be to estimate the difference between mu1 and mu2, where mu1 and mu2 are each means from different populations. So in the confidence interval situation, our point estimate is going to be the sample mean of the first group, x1 bar minus x2 bar, the sample mean of the second group. T star is going to be as before. You're either going to calculate it using the table or with a TI-83 calculator. And here I want to make the point that you should choose DF from the smaller group. The idea is, right, if you have a choice of DF, you should always go with the more conservative option so you're not estimating more than you're supposed to be estimating. Now, as far as the standard error is concerned, if you think back to the two proportion case, what we did is we took the variances of the proportions of each group and we added those together and took the square root. So that's exactly how it's going to work for two means. Our standard error is going to be the square root of the squared standard deviation of each group divided by the sample size from that group added together. So S1 squared plus N1 over S2 squared plus N2, where S1 SI is the sample standard deviation, and NI is the sample size of each group. Our confidence interval, as usual, is going to be the point estimate minus the multiplier times the standard error up to the point estimate plus the multiplier times the standard error. In the case of hypothesis testing, again, everything is pretty similar as before. Our null hypothesis, as in the two proportion case, is going to be that the two means are equal or that their difference is zero. Our alternative hypothesis is going to be that the difference in the two means is either less than zero, greater than zero, or not equal to zero, and we will take the p-value accordingly. Our test statistic is the difference in the two sample means minus the claimed null value of zero, which we typically will omit from the calculation, divided by the standard error. And the good news is that the standard error is the same as it is in the confidence interval case. Since the standard error for means doesn't have anything to do with the mean itself, the formula is going to be the same both in the confidence interval case and in the hypothesis test case. All right, so now we have our example. Six gill sharks sampled in the Puget Sound were measured and sexed. A summary of the results is given below. Is there significant evidence that the adult males are smaller on average than the females? Test this by first performing a hypothesis test and then using a 90% confidence interval. So in both of the two approaches, we're going to want our point estimate, which is x1 bar minus x2 bar. Reading the table from first row to second row, first row is females, second row is males. So the first row mean is 3.7 minus the second row mean is 3.2. And we get 0.5 as our point estimate. Then the standard error is going to be the same no matter what approach we're taking. So let's compute that as well. We're going to have 0.40 squared divided by 51 plus 0.35 squared divided by 26. And that comes out to be 0.0866. So in our hypothesis test, we're going to have the null is always the statement that the two means are equal. The alternative, if we think that the adult males are smaller on average and our first mean was that of the female sharks, then our alternative hypothesis is that mu1 minus mu2 is greater than zero because we believe the females are longer. All right, then our test statistic is the point estimate, 0.5, the difference in the two means, minus 0, divided by the standard error, which is 0.0866. And that gives us 5.6433. So we have this distribution of differences of sample means, supposedly centered at 0 if the null hypothesis is true. So our test statistic is all the way out here at 5.6433. Since the alternative hypothesis is that the true difference in the means is greater than 0, our more extreme situation is going to be this pink shaded area here. Therefore, our p-value is going to be the t-CDF from our test statistic 5.6433 up to 9999. And we have to specify that we have 25 degrees of freedom because the smaller n was 26. And that gives us a p-value of 0.0000036. And we're not surprised at all by how small that is because 5.6 is a very unlikely test statistic. So we interpret that p-value as follows. If the null were true, so in context, what does that mean for the null to be true? If male and female six gill sharks were the same length, we'd see our data or something more extreme .00036% of the time. Since that number is well below 1%, our conclusion is that there is very strong evidence that male six gill sharks are smaller, which is our alternative hypothesis. Remember, the conclusion is always stated in terms of the alternative. All right, next, let's take a look at the confidence interval situation. T star, looking at our table of multipliers, so we're using the inverse t function with a degrees of freedom of 25. And since we're doing 90% confidence, that's going to be inverse t of 0.95. So we could do this, or we could just look at the table. We get a t star of 1.708. Multiplying that by our standard error gives us a margin of error of 0.1513. So therefore, our confidence interval is 0.5 minus 0.1513 up to 0.5 plus 0.1513, which is 0.3487, 0.6513. So the interpretation of that interval is that we are 90% confident that female six gill sharks are between 0.3487 and 0.6513 feet longer than males. So I want to point out a couple of things here. I could have said that we are 90% confident that the difference in the means is between 0.3487 and between 0.6513, but I want to add as much flavor to the sentence as possible, frame it squarely in terms of our context. The other thing that I want to point out is even though they're decimals, I resist the temptation to multiply them by 100% because they're not proportions. They are difference in means. So it would be incorrect to multiply by 100% here. The units are feet, not percent. Notice the duality. Since we have very strong evidence for the alternative, that means that zero is not in our confidence interval, because the confidence interval is the range of likely values for the parameter, which in this case is the difference of the means. Our alternative hypothesis is likely, so the difference in the means is likely not zero, so zero is not going to be included in our interval, so all of this stuff checks out.